The year is 1095 AD, and there are three major cultures in the Western world. The Latins under Pope Urban II. This is a feudal Europe controlled by many nobles and knights. To the east is the Byzantine Empire, ruled by Emperor Alexius I. And even further to the east are the Seljuk Turks, a collection of Muslim lordships under the Caliph of Baghdad, a position in much turmoil at the moment. Despite this, the Turks have managed to complete a successful campaign against the Byzantines, conquering much of their land. This means a lot of things. The Latins want Jerusalem back in Christian control. The Byzantines want their land back, and the Turks just want more. A concerned Alexius sends a letter to Pope Urban requesting military aid from Europe. A few hundred knights will do. Seeing an opportunity to unite Europe, gain Byzantine favor, and repel the Muslims all at the same time, the Pope decides on a much grander gesture. He calls a council at Clermont, France. With many clergy and nobles in attendance, he announces his big plan, the Crusade. Whoever participates gets an indulgence granting remission for all previous sin. The crowd loves the idea so much they shout, Deus vult, a Latin phrase meaning, God wills it. Urban takes his show on the road, getting nobles from all across Europe to join. It's a hit. Except for with the monarchy. Due to numerous political issues and one excommunication, no kings joined the First Crusade. This left less powerful nobles to take leadership positions. These nobles included brothers Godfrey and Baldwin, both skilled soldiers, Count Stephen of Blois, son-in-law to William the Conqueror, Count Raymond of St. Giles, a man in his 60s that sold all his land to help the Crusade, and most controversial of all, Bohemond of Taravanto, who had taken part in a war against the Byzantine Empire just 10 years earlier. With all their leaders assembled, the Crusaders departed. Thousands of men from all across Europe, of every rank and stature, gathered at the Byzantine capital of Constantinople. Alexius was surprised by the army's huge size. He made a deal with the Crusaders that Greek lands such as Antioch would be returned to Byzantine control if captured. The rest would be left to the Crusaders. In mid-1097, a joint Crusader-Byzantine force departed and assaulted the town of Nicaea. By June, the town's defenders had surrendered. The army's Byzantine element departed, and the Crusaders divided their army. Baldwin left for Edessa. Bohemond and Stephen headed for Antioch, while Godfrey and Raymond continued south to Jerusalem. The Christian Armenians of Edessa welcomed Baldwin. Their leader, Thoros, adopted Baldwin as his son in a ritual where the two men took their shirts off and hugged. A large white shirt was then placed on top of both of them. This ritual later proved beneficial when Thoros was beaten to death by an angry mob, allowing Baldwin to add Edessa to his own domain. Meanwhile, in Antioch, the Crusaders were not having such a good time. A siege had just been established against the well-fortified city in October. In June of the next year, Bohemond made a deal with the other Crusaders. If he could get them into the city, he would rule it. However, this broke their deal with Alexius, but they agreed under the condition that Bohemond would only rule if Alexius did not arrive to aid the Crusaders. On June the 3rd, Bohemond contacted an Armenian agent inside the walls that let the Crusaders inside the city. With the gates open, the city was sacked and many inhabitants were massacred. But it was not over yet. The defenders retreated into the town's citadel, and the siege resumed. Soon, another Muslim force arrived and surrounded the Crusaders. They were trapped, and it did not look good. Stephen of Blois took his men and fled the city, leaving his fellow Crusaders behind. Even worse, on his route back home, he encountered Alexius' army. Stephen told Alexius the battle would soon be lost, and there was no point in continuing on. Alexius returned to Constantinople. On June 23rd, the battle-hardened Crusaders prepared for a final assault on the surrounding army. If they failed, the entire Crusade would be lost. After 2 years of war, the Crusaders knew the Turkish tactics and were prepared. They won the battle. With the larger surrounding army defeated, the citadel defenders surrendered. Antioch had been conquered. With Alexius never coming to fight, the city came under the control of Bohemond. Once stability was obtained, many Crusaders marched onward to join the rest of the army in Jerusalem. but some, such as Bohemond, stayed to strengthen Christian control in the area. On June 27th of 1099, the first Crusaders reached Jerusalem. Under Godfrey and Richard's leadership, they built two siege towers, several catapults, and a ram. One time, an Egyptian spy was caught in the Crusader camp and returned to Jerusalem via catapult. In retaliation, the Muslim defenders spent the next day urinating on crosses. The situation was getting tense, and it was only going to get worse. Running out of supplies and water due to the Saracen poisoning of wells and farmland, the Crusaders had limited time to act. They were applying pressure to Jerusalem's walls with their siege equipment, but no gains had been made. On July the 13th, Godfrey noticed a weak portion of the wall and had a genius idea. That night, his siege tower would be disassembled, moved a mile down the wall to the weak point, and be reassembled, all before dawn. The following day, the battering ram was set upon the outer walls to create a breach for the siege tower. After many hours of fighting to protect the ram while it worked, the Crusaders broke through. On the 15th, Godfrey's tower advanced on the inner walls. Both sides fought hard throughout the day, but the Crusaders gained a major advantage when a fire arrow ignited amongst the walls. Godfrey ordered the tower's drawbridge to be lowered, and the Crusaders charged the Saracens. After defeating the forces on the northern wall, more Crusaders climbed on the ladders into the city. Soon, the Saracen ranks collapsed. With the battle for Jerusalem won, the Crusader army began a cruel massacre of Jerusalem's population. Not even women and children were spared from these evils, as the Latins stole goods and ended lives. After Jerusalem had been sacked and its streets filled with blood, the Crusaders began a pilgrimage to the holy sites of Jerusalem. Soon, Godfrey was appointed as ruler of the Kingdom of Jerusalem. However, he believed that no man should be king in the land of God, so he gave himself the more humble title, Advocate of the Holy Sepulchre. And thus ended the First Crusade. The path of war had been torn through the Levant, and after many struggles and triumphs, ended in victory for Europe's armies.